I felt alone for most of my adolescent life. People might think I'm very extroverted, but inside I feel very alone. Most people feel they're familiar with me and call me Zoo, but only a handful of people have ever attempted to know me as a true friend. When I'm at school, I feel like an observer more than a participant. Most people know I'm pretty musical. I have my own musical project where I record everything by myself. I'm currently getting interest from Columbia Records, Sub Pop, Bella Union in the UK, etc. I spent 9 months writing another record with over 60 songs. I've narrowed it down to 12, and this is the first time where I'm happy and excited about every song, every sound. I don't understand why people are always trying to understand my actions as opposed to who I really am. Honestly, I would trade away my love for music to feel love towards humanity, to try to fit in harder.
Should I look into the camera? Where's the camera?
If you want. Yeah, this is the camera.
That's the camera right there, because sometimes I look up here, I'm not sure what the camera is. All right. I don't remember when I first met him that he would come into my room and do his gorilla pentagram shtick, or he would break out into a heavy metal warbler and just do the and run around and go I think he goes to school just to sort of see what's going to happen, and if nothing's happening, he tries to make things happen.
First time I met Alex Zoo was in middle school, and he told me he had Tourette's. I believed him because it just seemed plausible.
First time I met Zoo was in English class, and I thought like he was nuts.
He is so weird and so annoying that is frightening.
Keeney, we are neighbors. What the hell are you talking about?
Yeah.
Eat that stupid sandwich, okay?
And
get out of here. Get out of here, Keeney. Get out! Stop filming! Get out of here!
For like every week,
he's out there.
Every day for lunch, he goes to Brooklyn.
No.
Okay. He was like the one person that I was warned about. He just started listing perf bands to me. I'm like, how do you know this?
He's definitely got a hard candy shell, but definitely a very, very soft center.
Just comes in here and it's like I get 5 minutes, 10 minutes of Zoo sort of splattering everywhere, and then he goes off and he bugs Dr. Monroe. But he probably walks 3 or 4 miles just in school, ping-ponging from one space to the next. And you can hear his laugh everywhere because it's infectious, contagious.
It was like the first day of school and I was like, who's that weird kid with the like matching floral, like
the pants.
The pants.
Okay. Yeah.
I literally care so little right now in my life. I don't care. I take off all my clothes. Sorry, people. It's called art. Understand it.
He's who he is. He's the Zoo. Like, if this were the National Zoo down in D.C., I could see walking the apes, there are the monkeys, there are the giraffes, and there's the Zoo. Like, behind bars, he'd have his amp, he'd have his guitar, he'd just look at us, and then every once in a while, he'd take the duck upside down, the plastic duck, and then he'd shoot at people, right? And then he'd go back, and then maybe he'd sing, and then sometimes he'd get sort of down, so he'd just sit there, play the guitar again, and maybe sing some, and I don't know what you'd throw him to keep him going. Maybe vinyl, new vinyl. So I don't think he's anyone, I don't think he's another animal, I don't think he's anyone else. I mean, there's nobody else like him. So, and the last name seems to fit, so.
It's like, there's so much energy in Alex Zoo. His Instagram is pictures of blank space. I don't know, like, zooms in of paperclips.
I mean, like, he often does accost me in the cafeteria or in the hall. And I think it's just because he knows that I set boundaries, and I'll, like, I spray bottle him to, like, I'm like, no, go away
for like me. Like a cat.
Yes. And he just likes that I'm sassy and will, like, put him in his place. But, like, one day he had that panda costume on, and he had to make sure I saw it, and anytime he has a new floral print or something.
Yesterday he needed some advice on whether he should frost his tips or not. And if so, what color he should choose to frost them? Yeah,
Good thing we put that one to rest.
Hey, what's up? This is Ray Lego. Alex's hair and his fashion is epic. I love it. I won't change it. I will keep it. We will shoot it, and it will rock.
He comes in here. He always has to pick up the rubber duck, turn it upside down, and then pretend it's some kind of gun. He's in his mind, I don't know what he's imagining, but I think he's imagining erasing all of us like it's a remote control. Probably. He doesn't care what other people think, but then those are often the people who care the most about what other people think, so it's sort of tricky that way.
Thanks, Dr. Moreau. I'm really thankful for your compliment about me today. You look great too today, I think. Thanks for your compliment on my clothing choice. Oh, you don't think? You think I'm a genius? Oh my god, Doc.
He's definitely someone who's got a lot of enthusiasm for whatever subject it is you're talking to him about. So I would say, though, that he came across as distinctive right away.
Okay, don't put this on camera, because I'm straight up, like, this is the worst test I've ever taken in APA. Okay, what do you
mean? We can reveal Alex's score after
no,
it's done.
No!
I don't really know. I think coming to high school, I don't think high school has taught me a lot of things really, you know, important.
He's always kind of come in here with, you know, these urgent life questions that he needs to get answered. You know, emergency, unannounced concerts in Bushwick that he absolutely had to get tickets to. A lot of questions on, you know, generally coolness, what's not cool. I mean, one of the things I think is really important in this school to have, like, people like Alex around is because Princeton can be a somewhat conservative place. And, you know, we go to a school where I think there's a level of acceptedness and conformity of what is cool or what's acceptable. And if that's in this middle ground here, well, then Alex needs to make sure that it's here. And as long as you have people like Alex that are pushing these boundaries of what's acceptable, then I think you can have a community where you have arts thriving and saying it's okay to be different. Like, I have lived in the city for a long time and had a lot of friends that went to Brooklyn art schools, and Alex and that environment would be just another kid. But in here, he's this white tiger, this rarity. You know, in that way, I think it's a great place for him, and he needs that conformity to kind of revolt against.
I believe that there's like two parts of Alex. So there's the part that he is at school, and that part, not, it's devolved, if anything. He's way worse. But like the real Alex, he's definitely matured. Like, he's a better person, but no one sees that.
I try to be the same person just because I just am who I am and stuff, but at the same time though, like, I can talk about the same stuff, but the reception is completely different when I'm at PDS and when I'm not at PDS.
So the first time I met Alex was in seventh grade, and the first thing that he tried to do to me was hit me in the nuts. So I felt like it wasn't a great start.
So when we were in like middle school, and like up until then, we listened to like a lot of heavy metal. Black metal, death metal, doom metal, sludge metal, drone metal, groove metal, new metal, all the metals. And then we stopped listening to that. And then he was kind of like gotten to like the psychedelic, like druggy stuff that we listen to now.
It's like this weird like spray sound on us. Hey, what's up? My name's Al Zhu and welcome to my crib. HGTV stuff, not MTV stuff, so that's a bit too random. Okay, I personally warm up, but I first work this leg a little bit, this one, because this is not my strong leg. I do that for a little bit, and I do this leg. And then afterwards, I'm pretty much good. Yeah, Mom, what? This is the first stringed instrument I ever played, because no one here played bass, and everyone always needed a bassist in middle school, and I was like, I can play bass. This is my Gibson Les Paul R8 historic custom shop. It's like the best sounding guitar I have. It's
to like this crazy seafoam greeny blue, that natural back. There are certain guitars, like, there's certain things on this guitar, like the wear patterns that you know it's me, like on the back. Like there's no buckle rash because I never wear buckles while playing live, while playing shows or even practicing. But there is some like scratches from like zippers and stuff because I always wear hoodies when I play. This is one of the guitars with like a weird story. The body is a 60s body. It's like an original Fender Jaguar body from the 60s. It was refinished in white and now it's just turned this cream color from like playing in bars and stuff and cigarette smoke. This is a weird guitar also in the sense that the body is a 70s Stratocaster body, really light. It's like just, like it weighs nothing. It's like really weird to me. It's how light it is. I mean, this guitar screams expression. The last cool guitar I own is this 1967 Fender Coronado 12 string. Found it in Japan, in this weird kooky vintage guitar store in Japan, in Tokyo. Picked it off the wall and it's amazing. It sounds so good. Yeah, it sounds floating bridge with the Mustang style saddles, original wiring harness, original toggle switch, original tuners. The thing about guitars from the 60s and the 50s was the aniline dye they used was not UV resistant. So when they put it out in the storefronts, the sunlight would actually, the dye would actually dissipate due to the UV rays from the sun.
Like I played guitar since like third grade and he picked it up like sophomore year and he just kind of decided like I'm gonna make real music and now he has a studio and he has a drum kit and he has recording equipment and I'm jealous. It's awesome.
Everyone knows I'm all right. Everyone knows I love her. But everyone else wants her. And she doesn't want someone like me.
Not being really recognized by for doing this by my peers is also kind of a bummer. Because I frankly think this is way cooler than beating Lawrence Watt hockey or something like that, or some bullshit like that. I mean, like, seriously, like.
So what I had heard is kind of like miasma, beach, surf, rock, and with, you know, I'd say the instrumentation is way up front and the vocals are a little bit behind, and if I were Alex, I'd push myself to the front a little bit more.
I hope that on his own, he will think outside of the box a little more. When it comes to music, he's already outside of the box, which is why I love that kid. So he was like over there against the wall, hanging out with the lamp, and we were like, hey, I love lamp, and he was like, I love lamp. So I just started playing chords, and he started singing about lamp, and then like the lamp song just evolved into whatever feelings were happening, and that was the day that we were just like hashing out things, and it was just a moment.
All the books said the day he was born, yeah. That's his interest in the, you know, music.
Yeah, he's a lot of his mind is a lot of the art, like artistic oriented person.
And
yeah,
too,
it's kind of, we can see the course he went through. It's he's trying to develop different things, try out different kind of music. And I think he finally found what he thinks he's most familiar with, I guess.
Alex started playing pianos when he was 5 years old. So all along.
Actually, when he was kindergarten, he likes the kindergarten music.
There was a kinder music program we put him in, and then he
Flemington,
chose.
Yes.
Yeah, he chose piano.
He loves the music of
Tarzan.
Yeah.
Yes.
Tarzan movie. You know, every day, morning, afternoon, when I pick him up, he just listening.
Yeah.
Listen. Oh, make me crazy, the music. All minutes. More
whole
than
day.
10 times, whole days.
Yeah.
Just listening to music.
Yeah.
He was sixth grade. He changed to like a...
Like rock and roll
rock
type
and roll
of thing.
Pop the cuff. And he's crazy to shake his head.
I think when you're like 7th, when you're like 13 or 14 or whatever, you're like, it's like the age of like prepubescence. It's like puppy angst. Like you're angsty for like 2 years. Like you think like you're angsty for only 2 years, but then you actually just get angstier for the rest of your life and stuff. You don't even know that.
he sometimes he's singing in the house. I was so scared. What's going on with him? Well, I didn't support him that much. But he keep nagging.
Oh, this is me actually at Han. This is sixth grade Han.
You know, like the band teacher is like, you know, we could do like a little rock band or whatever, like thing, you know. Well, we were gonna play the song "Breaking the Girl" by the Red Hot Chili Peppers, but like Anthony Kiedis dropped like too many fucks in that like, song, like so that was like a no go. And then afterwards, right, Ben and Tom and Dan are like, we should totally do Dead Kennedys' "Holiday in Cambodia," which is even more fucks being dropped. And then I remember Samantha was just like, oh, we should do some Avril Lavigne song. And then like, so then we had this entire like poll whether or not we wanted to either play Avril Lavigne or the Dead Kennedys.
We are just normal people, normal family. So I want he can, you know, finish his college and get a normal job. The job can make money, support him.
I think something's gonna happen pretty big with him. I really do, as far as his music is concerned, because he's very talented and he's completely passionate, and he already has that hyper focus that you need. And he's really focused on one thing, music, and he's making connections in the outside world. And the,
you know, we did well, I mean, the best thing I think you could do is like do some of your stuff on your own, you know, and work with that, and then some of the stuff do there, but then after that, fuck with it again.
So
you're not like,
and also the mixing, you know, was really difficult because I wasn't there for the mixing and stuff.
Mixing is everything.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean,
you know, part of the lore of creating a rock legend in the making is, you know, the myth behind them. So Alex is always kind of, you know, a bit of a raconteur in describing Alex. Like, oh, I was, you know, with the Vivian girls last night on like a Tuesday. Like, it's either all true or part of it's true, or, you know, I mean, I think he wants to live this larger than life lifestyle.
No, actually, I base my storytelling voice off of the predator hunter on like Fox. You know, the guy who like the predator. It's like, hey, like, he like pretends like the girls are calling some pizza dude who wants like wait. But then he was like, please sit down. Let's have a chat. Put the pizza down. And then the guy's like, no, I do not want to be on TV.
At least he has stories. At least he's interesting enough to lead these lives where he has all these stories. Oh, Q, I was walking in New York, 3:00 in the morning, there's nobody else there, and I was talking to this guy named Bob.
When we went on an after party, in Bushwick, I think. Yeah, he was across the street from Silent Bar, or Sound Bar, or whatever. I obviously got really messed up. Took some Xanax.
That's why I wanted to be
here. Don't really remember the rest of the night.
Dude, holy fuck, did I not tell you? Oh my god, talking about Nick and Nora's playlist, Michael Cera. I met him that weekend. And you know what else? It's like he's standing there like, I'm on my iPhone like everyone else, right? Everyone is on an iPhone at the venue. He's on like a flip phone from like 2003 and it's like covered in medical tape.
That's hardcore.
But no, I'll never forget that. I was
broke.
We were both broke.
I was miserable.
I had my backpack
he
on.
He drugged me to this hole in the wall in Brooklyn. I'm standing there watching these shitty punk bands, and this kid comes dancing over me with a beer. I was like, dude, I'm
not put any of this in the documentary.
Look, he's a musician. I think that's what really drives him. So, you know, I think he has a lot of other interests and hobbies, but I think, you know, from a fellow tinkerer and musician, like, you, there's only so much time in the day, so.
It's like, when I go to sleep, I try to go to sleep, but I'll be in bed for, like, hours. I cannot sleep. I'm just thinking, like, how if I, like, recorded, you know, a solid body guitar and then put, and then overlaid, like, a hollow body guitar, how would that sound? It gets painful because I cannot sleep. There are times when, like, I, like, listen back to it and I'm like, wow, this is complete crap. Like, this makes no sense to the album. Like, I don't know why I just wrote it. Like, this is absolute shit. It's easier to
think you're dumb. And then I'll have these very sort of down, serious times when he'll say, nobody understands me here. And I think, well, A, how could anyone really understand you, because I don't understand you, but I understand that you're really interested in life and learning and you're alive and you really want to make music, and that's great. So that much I understand. He doesn't get that if you're an artist, you are in tune with your own feelings and thoughts. And so you are going to feel isolated, and that's when you create. And I shambled, as I've been doing all my life, shambled after people who interest me. Because the only people for me are the mad ones. The ones who are mad to live, mad to talk, mad to be saved, desirous of everything at the same time. The ones who never yawn or say a commonplace thing, but burn, burn, burn like fabulous yellow Roman candles exploding like spiders across the stars. And in the middle, you see the blue center light pop, and everybody goes, aww.